Chapter 5 Power of the Spoken Word. 1. The spoken word has a great power, but there is one thing certain: we must select the words and then we must give them power. There is no power in a negative word unless we do select and give the word power. It does not of itself contain power. Power must be given to the word by the one who speaks it. Of course, as the Eastern philosophy goes, the thought which precedes the word is more important. Consequently, the thought can be the motivating force behind the spoken word, and in that way it adds power and, as the masters put it, that word must go forth and create. 2. Now, if a word is spoken idly or without force of thought, it does not accomplish. By the selection of that word, the power given to it through thought cannot help but accomplish that very thing for which it is sent. That is why they claim such selectivity for the spoken word, and that is why they say the spoken word is always selective. 3. That power which we put back of the word to accomplish must be the energy that we ourselves perceive. As they put it, not the energy which you give to the word, but the energy that you perceive for the accomplishment of that word is what matters. 4. Jesus said, "My words are spirit and they are life, and they do accomplish that whereunto they are sent." Spirit is the creative cause in the universe, and our words are potent only as this same spirit is seen as the operative force back of them. It is the activity of the force of nature that makes the seed grow, for no seed has power within itself. It is a container or vehicle of that force. So it is with words. The scriptures say, the word is a seed, and the power of spirit acts upon words as nature does upon the seed. Our consciousness or awareness of spirit is the focal point in this matter of the power of the word. Idle words are impotent and do not create, though they, in a sense, may add to the state of hypnosis. To fear negative words is to add to their hypnotic energies, and it thereby adds to the influence of the negative word. The power of ignorant or idle words is only that they may intensify the hypnotic state of man's mind, but they do not alter the creative cause in the least. The power of negative words is only the modernization of the old idea of the devil, and is a direct violation of the fact that there is only the power of God. There is no power opposed to the ultimate good in the universal trend. That which seems to be opposition is in our own minds, which often work contrary to the divine purpose. The creative trend of the universe, or the will and purpose of God, is to dissolve ignorance just as light dissolves darkness. 5. We have seen them, used in this sense always refers to the masters, put forth a word, and what the word represented would come into existence immediately. There was no time element at all. In fact, there is no way of placing a time element upon the spoken word if the energy, spirit, is in it. As they put it, a word spoken directly with the impetus of true thought behind it must create that very condition instantly. It is quite evident that the Western world looks upon a word as less potent. That is, a word may be spoken, but, with no energy behind it, it loses its potency entirely. It is often said that this is why the Western world gets into such childish prattle. It fails to put the proper value upon its words. 6. Now, the thought which possesses the proper selectivity, or which possesses the force that belongs to it, should always be given to the word, not to drive that word through will or the force of the will, but to give that word the power which belongs to it. That, of course, is the power of the spirit, and this is included in our words only through highly selected thought, thought which corresponds to the creative purposes of the universe. In that way the will, which has directive ability, sends the word forth, but it is not the will that gives power to the spoken word. The will selects or enters into the selection of thought and the speaking of the word, but the power is conceded or admitted through an enlarged consciousness of the presence and power of spirit. But, when a word is selected for its meaning or its use, it is always selected in the frequency where it belongs and is placed there. 7. This should eliminate the fear which many have of negative words, and at the same time should inspire the individual to a more intelligent selection of his words and how to put them to better use. To think the thoughts of God after him would be the essence of spiritual power, for back of such words would be the very power that created the heavens and the earth. Man's words should always be an outlet for his own innate spiritual nature, and a means of establishing this spiritual nature in his outer being. To speak only in harmony with the highest and most constructive ideals would be to speak with the greatest power, and, in this way, that which seems the greatest improbability would become the most probable, in that such words have the greater power. In other words, the more godlike the thought, the realization, and the consciousness, the greater the power involved in the process. 8. As the Eastern philosophers express it, you could not be separated from principle one iota if you would use selective words. Therefore, every word that is put out can be selective. Then you are not energizing a negative condition. You are only giving energy to that one conclusion. 9. The Hindu, or the Aryan always puts it, man is the creator of words, therefore, man is the selector or he has dominion over those words and he selects or places words in existence which must operate or become potent. Now, in the measure that he uses this fact rightly, there is no way of connecting that power with negative words, as they put it. Consequently, negative words do not enter into or have any consideration from the individual who wishes to manifest forms. This thought of manifest form is always that condition brought into existence wherein man is able to create. That is where man has dominion over every word spoken. The Sanskrit language in one of its phases allows for that condition. There is in that the power to manifest. By that we mean that one position of the Sanskrit language allows only four positive words, or statements. That is, words that can be made into positive statements and from these there is no deviation. 10. Naturally, everyone asks what those four positive words are. They are always words which mean the positive declaration of facts. Each one can select them. Of course, the most positive word is the first word, God. Going back to the principle, you would formulate your statement with that as a basis, you would formulate with that word whatever positive sentence you wished. Thereby is the power of the spoken word. Your key word is always the highest, or God. Then you select the words which accompany that for your positive declaration. 11. Just as all mathematical calculation springs from the unit symbolized by the figure 1, so must all words emanate from a single derivative, or principle. God is an, because God is, I am. Because God is life, I am life. Because God is intelligence, I am intelligence. Because God is power, I am power. Because God is all substance, I am substance, etc. Father in Sanskrit means first mover and the first movement of the mind of the individual must always emanate from the one source and it must be sustained through the consciousness of the individual. To admit anything into the individual consciousness that does not originate in the facts of God is to adulterate the process of life in himself and, to this extent, he becomes unaware of the fullness of his divinity. He must give himself to the underlying facts of life in their entirety, he must tarry at Jerusalem, his contact with the All, until the Holy, or entire Spirit of God is the motivating energy of his every thought, word, and act. 12. Man cannot express a word or thought outside of his own field of competency with any manifesting power. He cannot go outside of that field because that very word which he expresses creates the field in which he acts. 13. The average person does not really know what a word is. It is merely a vehicle used in the processes of mind to convey or extend certain processes of the mind. The word cannot convey that which is not in the mind. Webster says that a name implies the essential nature of a thing. A word is only a name for certain states of consciousness and that is something that rests with the individual himself. One person may say, I am happy, and it would convey nothing to another individual hearing the word. If his consciousness is only a bit joyous, his words would convey but little authority. But if he were radiant with joy, his words would convey complete conviction. Idle words are empty words, words which do not contain the consciousness and realization of spiritual facts. You see, a word as we use it is just what it contains and the content of the word is determined by our consciousness and our consciousness is determined by the degree of intelligent selection which we use. 14. It is not repetition that makes a word effective. Your first declaration, if it be true, is sufficient. There is nothing left to do but stand by your statement, abide in your word. Repetition, however, is often an effective means of bringing one into accord with the possibilities contained within a statement. One often repeats a sentence or rule over and over before the meaning is clearly revealed to his consciousness. Without this expansion of the mind toward the inner facts, repetition is only hypnotic. 15. If man repeats words and they do not become hypnotic to him, this repetition brings him into closer accord with the facts back of the words. It affects a higher realization. It is worthwhile to repeat up to a certain point and then it is not worthwhile even to repeat because your word is established unto you. When you understand that your word is clearly established, repetition is of no more value whatever. In reality, we come to understand that our word is always established and we never repeat it. 16. If the manifestation of your word does not appear, that is no proof of its ineffectiveness. The better policy in such a case is to give thanks that the manifestation is there. You get out of doubt completely in that way. But, by going on and repeating your word, you may very quickly begin to engender doubt, whereas, if you give thanks, you are more closely in harmony with your word and become more easily aware that your word is established. 17. The mere repetition of a word does not establish it any more firmly. It only brings you into harmony with that which is. It is very often possible to bring yourself into more harmonious relationship by giving thanks that it is here now and that it is established. 18. When one realizes that the whole problem of manifest results is more a matter of opening up the consciousness to see or include something which already exists in fact, instead of trying to bring something that is not out into manifest form, then the matter will be much simpler. It is, the land thou seest, that will I give unto thee as an inheritance, that contains all the mystery. It is a fact in spirit, it is a fact everywhere and on all so-called planes, for there is only one plane and that is spiritual. As the mind expands to see or grasp the spiritual fact, there can be no question whatever about the manifestation of that fact. If it is so in God, it is so everywhere, for God is all. It is all a matter of awareness upon our part, and our awareness must be expanded to include the reality and existence of the spiritual fact. 19. That was Jesus' method of working. Every word was established unto him. He exalted every word through his exalted consciousness, knowing that it was already in existence. The Hindu stands in the same position. He states his declaration and then he may say that it is finished. He takes the attitude that it is already finished, it is already in existence, it is his, and then he goes on. One accomplishes far more in that way than to go back to the repetition, and it seems to always make one stronger. 20. In the matter of treatment of so-called disease, the average metaphysician makes the mistake of dealing with the opposites, disease and health. Here are two conditions, the one to replace the other. In the East they do not work in this way any more than did Jesus. When you seek for perfection, know that it is established unto you. Exalt perfection. Perfection exists independent of both the opposites of health and disease. Perfection is an eternally established fact in principle, and it is complete within itself on every so-called plane. Both health and disease are delusions according to Eastern philosophy, for they are only human concepts. For instance, your own idea of health today would not suffice you in 5 years from now, for health is a relative idea in your own consciousness. There is nothing relative in being, all is complete, all is perfect, and the true practitioner identifies himself with reality and does not deal with delusion. Let go of the opposites altogether and put in their place the perfection. We find that Jesus did not in any instance treat with the opposites. He put into the place of both the opposites the true perfection. His great statement was perfection always, and that perfection was always established unto him. 21. If I place on the blackboard the figures 2 plus 2 equals 3 and then follow with 2 plus 2 equals 5, would you deal with the 3 and 5 and try to establish the right answer? No, you would go right through these figures, deal with the fact that 2 plus 2 equals 4, and both these extremes would vanish. That which is less or more than the correct answer has nothing to do with the fact in principle, and it is only by bringing the fact of principle to bear upon the situation that any correct answer is possible. Our ideas of health and disease are both less than the perfection which is established in the foundations of the universe, and never can that which is less than perfection be made into perfection. You are dealing with something unrelated to either of these extremes. Be ye perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect, is the correct standard of procedure here. 22. Most people fail in the so-called demonstration because they make a statement of perfection and then immediately begin to look back into the matter of the opposites. Only, if thine eye be single shall thy body be filled with light. Lot's wife turned and saw double and her body became stone or salt. Now, henceforth and forever, see only perfection, said Jesus. The moment that we establish perfection, the Christ stands forth dominant. Each works to establish the other, for the fact in spirit is the form of its manifestation. 23. The effect of true spiritual treatment is not dependent upon the degree of unfoldment or spiritual development of the person treated. We need not bother about his consciousness, for it is based upon the opposites, else he would not be ill. The spiritual fact is, in the moment we stand in perfection, our consciousness is perfect as well. 24. Speaking the word is never hypnotic, for it is the essence of the true nature of all creation. Treatment, or speaking the word, is not projecting our ideas of health to offset disease. This latter is hypnotic. Speaking the word is only telling the truth, declaring that which always has been and always will be true of any individual, condition, or circumstance, in principle. Hypnosis is a result of speaking from the human mind with its imperfect concepts. 25. It is not necessary that the sick or needy person ask for your help, nor that he be conscious that you are sending forth the word to him. If you send it forth on the Christ right ray, you are merely presenting his own innate perfection to him. In this way you liberate both yourself and him, for you are not dealing with anything but fact. You are not working against the will of any individual when you work with perfection, for the innate will of everyone is for perfection. This rather frees his will from its entanglements in the realm of false habits and concepts. There is no so-called influence in this sort of facing the situation. It is merely calling forth that which has always existed until it arrests the attention of everyone involved and they merely see that it is so. 26. There is power in the spoken word always if we see it as spirit, for then it can be nothing but spirit. We are the determinator. We are both the power and the expressor of that power, and we are the sole determinator of what that word shall carry with it. There is power in medicine on exactly this same basis. It is but the conveyor or means by which the mind of the patient is expanded to admit the creative authority of the universe. God is in the doctor, the patient, or the pill. Any individual, regardless of his profession or status, need only project the perfection. Of course, if we always would work in that perfection and manifestation of perfection, we soon would get out of medicine completely. Our word would heal. 27. There is no harm in using an agency in an attempt to minister to the needs of suffering mankind. There are many steps and many methods, but only one power. If our ideal is perfection, we are going to arrive at a point where there are no agencies. The agency which an individual employs only indicates the progress he has made in his own mind as to the suitable and most efficient means of admitting perfection into his being. One thinks it must come through a pill, one thinks it will come through affirmations, but, through whatever it comes, it is the perfection of principle that manifests. Only the highest ideals are adequate to contain the full measure of power that exists in divine principle, for the larger the container, the more can be conveyed. When the container and the contained are one, perfection, then it is complete in every plane. 28. In treating at a distance, or what metaphysicians call absent treatment, thought is more rapid and potent than words. Thought does not know time and space, while a word or audible sound belongs on the material plane and must traverse space and endure in time in order to reach its destination. Notice how instantly your thought is at the sun, the center of the earth, or at any other place. Thought does not travel, it is already there. Every fact in spirit is already there, and, further, it is already in evidence. To see this fact is to lift yourself into this fact, and to see it for another is to lift him into it. If I be lifted up, if the perceptive faculty is lifted up to the plane of reality, it draws all things into this realm. This is the true approach, rather than to try to lift anything or anybody into the perfect state. We might as well try to make energy out of earth by using the pick and shovel. 29. We know a man in India who walks through a storm just by the presentation of perfection of that storm. He will walk through a storm and never get wet. We have seen him stop fires and storms. Man himself is the word of God if he abides in that word. If ye abide in my word and my word abides in you, then are you in me even as I am in you, is the truth of the whole thing. When Jesus sent his word and healed the centurion's daughter, he did not send anything as we measure it in the three-dimensional world. Jesus, or Christ, was the word himself, and there was not anything that was made but that which was made by the same word. Therefore, the word which he sent did not traverse space, for the word was there as the truth of the centurion's daughter, just as it was with him. He simply announced a universally true spiritual fact, and outer minds became awakened to this fact. 30. Our remedies often ourselves do lie, which we ascribe to heaven. Shakespeare. For the teacher. Paragraph 1. Was not man given dominion over all things in the beginning? If that be the case, that same power is resident within man yet, and all the seeming power which anything has over man is the working out of power which he himself has assigned to that thing. But, even though the power seems to emanate from the thing or from a person, the power is really within the individual, for that is where its activity moves and is felt. To govern the action and reaction of his own nature, therefore, would be one of man's primal secrets of power. To keep one's nature always working in perfect accord with the divine ideal of perfection would be to have all power in heaven and in earth. Paragraphs 2, 3 and 4. It should be clear to everyone, though it seems not to be, that the words we speak are no more power than cylinders in an automobile engine are power. They are vehicles of energy, and only the kind and degree of energy moving through them determines the power. When Jesus said, "My words are spirit," he meant to convey that he was conscious that the moving force of God was moving through what he said or thought, and it was this motivating energy which did the apparent healing. The assertion of fact is infinite in its potency in the face of that which is not fact. Follow this idea through with any illustration in the realm of truth and falsity, light and dark. Paragraph 5. The important point in this paragraph is to make the student realize what tremendous opportunity he is losing in idle talk. His words might as well be conveying an infinite energy that would free him from his mediocrity if he would only proceed intelligently. Paragraph 6 should be carefully considered, and we should differentiate between the natural impetus of an accepted fact and the imposition of our wills to force a condition which we imagine to be better than the one already existing. The acceptance of a thing given never involves what we call a forceful will. Receiving an offered gift is infinitely more effective than to attempt to force one to give you something that is not already within his mind to give. Accepting a fact that is universally true involves no supreme assertion of the individual will. Perfection does not come from projecting our own ideas, but from awakening to the knowledge that it is already the established order of things. Paragraph 7. Clearly free the student from the notion that negative words have power. They are only a waste of time and add to the state of hypnosis. The higher the ideal, the more illumined is the idea, the more powerful it becomes. Your lightest word is your most illumined word. Paragraph 8. Use right discrimination in the selection of words so they convey or project into the manifest world only that which conforms to your highest ideals. Paragraph 9. Man's dominion is over himself. His being is supposed to be the kingdom of heaven. Only the law governing infinite space should govern his thoughts and feelings, his bodily and manifest conditions. His sphere of rulership is within himself, heavenly only when that rulership is exercised according to the facts of principle. Paragraph 10 and 11 show clearly the origin of all constructive thoughts and words, and that the entire field of thought and action should be developed from this manner of procedure. Paragraph 12 and 13 show what is in the word that gives it power. Repetition versus realization. Paragraphs 14, 15 and 16. The function of words or the word is not to project something into being, but it is to expand the mind of man until he sees that which has always been from the beginning. Before Abraham was, I am, is just as true of every fact in spirit as it was of Christ. Paragraphs 17, 18 and 19 are a continuation of the same truth. Training the mind to see through its veil of hypnotism, the veil in the temple, to see through to the other side where all things are already perfect and in evidence. It is all a matter of training the mind to see. Paragraphs 20 and 21 contain practical advice not only for the metaphysician but also for the individual who wishes to help some friend in distress. So much of mental practice is purely hypnotic and only substitutes a condition that may be somewhat better for the condition that was already there. Why substitute one human state or conception for another when the perfection of God Himself is there waiting recognition? Paragraph 22. To stand by the fact regardless of the consequences is the procedure. There can be no loss but the loss of our illusion, and the gain is truth itself, so why should we hesitate? Paragraphs 23, 24, 25 and 26 are clearly enough defined and highly illuminating to everyone, but they may be enlarged upon out of the richness of the instructor's mind. Paragraph 27. The difference between the conveyor and the thing conveyed comprises all the difference with which we succeed in any kind of curative practice. It is the spirit that quickens, and the effectiveness of treatment is the amount of spirit admitted in the practice. Paragraphs 28 and 29 eliminate the idea that there is such a thing as absent treatment of disease, for in spirit there is no absence. Spirit is present at all times and in all places the same and needs only recognition.